Recently, I went to a call to action event, Speak Out, March, and Candlelight Vigil, that being Friday, in Albany. We met at Dana Park near Lark Street. We marched down Lark Street. We went to a Presbyterian church where mostly trans youth spoke about their experiences being trans and young. This is all in response to the recent loss of Leelah Alcorn, who's a trans-identified youth. And is organized by the Pride Center's Youth Committee. Trans Lives Matter. So I participated in that. I was carrying a sign, Stop Conversion Efforts on LGBT Minors from the Pride Agenda and Protect LGBT Youth. And I have a picture that was taken from the night by my friend who works for the Pride Agenda. So this is a segment from the suicide note that Leelah posted on Tumblr after her suicide. And the suicide note is why this story has gone viral and caught the attention of even mainstream media. This excerpt. My parents were pissed. They felt like I was attacking their image and that I was an embarrassment to them. They wanted me to be their perfect little straight Christian boy, and that's obviously not what I wanted. So they took me out of public school, took away my laptop and phone, and forbid me of getting on any sort of social media, completely isolating me from my friends. This was probably the part of my life when I was the most depressed. And she continues later, my death needs to be counted in the number of transgender people who commit suicide this year. I want someone to look at that number and say, that's fucked up, and fix it. Fix society, please. And, so that's a segment of her suicide note, which I will link to in the description. And, so that was the catalyst for all this recent conversation about conversion therapy. So, to start, I've talked about suicide before, but I want to start in the broadest sense. The United States Declaration of Independence has the well-known phrase, we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And I feel for trans people, especially trans youth, right now in America, our pursuit of happiness is denied to us. Our happiness doesn't seem to matter, especially as youth, but even as adults, people want to deny our right to be happy. Our right to liberty, the liberty over our own bodies and our own lives and our ways of identifying, our ways of being. Our liberty is denied to us in laws that don't protect us from discrimination in employment or housing. And finally, our lives are often denied to us, either because of this oppression that we face, leading us to commit suicide, as some far too many tragically do, or even the massive numbers that are murdered because of their trans status, because their gender identity just doesn't match what is socially acceptable. So our lives, our liberty, and our pursuit of happiness is denied to us, even though we are Americans. And our declaration of being American says that we should be endowed by those, by our Creator, all people. Now, medical doctors, many of them make a promise upon their graduation. It's an oath. When they're admitted as a member of the medical profession. And part of that oath talks about the health of their patient being their first consideration. That's their number one concern, is the health of the patient. And there's things in there about confidentiality. So the things that you tell your doctor, they're not supposed to divulge that to other people, to the public, to the government. I will not, this is part of the Geneva declarations, I will not permit considerations of age, disease or disability, creed, ethnic origin, gender, nationality, political affiliation, race, sexual orientation, social standing, or any other factor to intervene between my duty and my patient. Basically saying that based on somebody's gender or sexual orientation, which is included, that you should not consider that when you consider your duty to your patient's health. I will maintain the utmost respect for human life. I will not use my medical knowledge to violate human rights and civil liberties, even under threat. So these are some of the things that people in the medical profession swear to, and there's other variations on this, but these are some of the things that are pretty consistent. So some people might wonder, is being trans protected in the medical community? Well, the National Institutes of Health, which is our government, and the American Psychiatric Association, in their Diagnostic and Statistical Manual, and the Standards of Care for the Health of Transsexual, Transgendered, and Nonconforming People, as part of WPATH, both our government, American Psychiatric Association, which is the doctors who do this stuff, and there's a world body dealing specifically with transgender people, all talk about the ways that are medically accepted for what you do with trans people. And as far as I know, there's nothing in there about converting them or denying them their right to identify as they want. In most of these standards, the first step is to talk with a counselor, not to shame someone the way Leelah Alcorn was, or to push a religion on them. That's not what medicine is about. The purpose of that therapy session is to determine what is bothering a person. Just like any time you go to a therapist, they talk to you about your feelings, things that are going on in your life, things that might be causing the issue. And for many of us trans people, we will bring up, you know, this issue we have with the suppression of our gender that we feel inside based on what society thinks we should be or our parents think we should be. And in these governmental and medical and even world health organizations, their recommendations are to see a therapist who will assess if you have these gender dysphoria, or gender identity disorder, as some people call it. If you have gender dysphoria, the treatment isn't to remove that condition, because that is part of who we are as people. Just like you can't remove the sexuality of a homosexual person and turn them straight, you can't take the gender dysphoria from a trans person and make them okay to be the gender they're assigned at birth. And this is medically and governmentally known. But yet, it's still illegal for parents to have control over their kids in these medical issues. Now, there's pretty good legal precedent that if something is medically necessary or medically needed for somebody's life, then it is not possible for somebody to deny that treatment. Even the person themselves who has that condition can't deny that treatment if it's deemed appropriate and not risky. For instance, there's a recent case that was taken to court where the parents and the child who was the patient both did not want treatment. They both said, no, we don't want to be treated. And the child, we don't want treatment for the child who had cancer. And this particular form of cancer with treatment was more than 3/4 the chance of surviving if you get treatment. And the prognosis for, of course, not getting treatment is, now it is a difficult treatment, but it's not like a treatment that's guaranteed going to kill you. I mean, there's risks associated with any treatment, but when you balance the risk, the chance of her surviving was more than 75%. The risks of the treatment were pretty low. It's certainly not comfortable, but the chances of death for not getting treatment is pretty high. If you don't get treated for cancer, and it's a certain type of cancer, you're pretty much committing that you're going to die of this cancer if it's malignant within however many years it takes. So the courts agreed that this person could not refuse treatment. This is a very recent court decision, but similar court decisions have been made in other cases that barring a terminal illness that you cannot recover from, or extreme suffering that cannot be abated, barring those exceptions, those ethical considerations, you need to get treatment that will save your life. Now, some people feel like their religion should supersede those ethical considerations, like, I don't believe in this treatment on religious grounds. And there's people who will fight for that. But for one thing, it didn't seem like the religious beliefs of the child was taken into consideration. It seems like people want to defer to the beliefs of the parents, or that the parents should have say in what medical treatments that are necessary that their kids get, and I don't believe that should be the case. And many of these groups have agreed that therapy and transition is necessary for some trans people. It's not necessary for everyone. It depends on what they determine through a diagnosis, through a period of understanding the person and what would be good for them. But for many trans people, it is medically necessary to transition, or the amount of problems that can be caused is unacceptable to their lives. So I think because it's a mental thing, and like many mental types of medical issues, it's easy for people to ignore it. And because it's so opposed by conservatives and some religions, some people's interpretation of religions, people I think it's okay to deny or to shame people for what is really medically necessary and approved by every major body that deals with these issues, every major authority that has a right to have a say in it. Now, it's one thing to say, well, I'm a parent and I want to raise my child a certain way. It's another thing to deny somebody medically necessary treatments and to deny their life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness. Those basic, fundamental rights that we all have as human beings. And I feel like until we pass a law that prevents parents, especially, from denying trans youth the right to seek counseling, and for that counselor and them to have the power to make decisions about their life, their liberty, and their happiness, it's really up to the individual. It's not like other types of decisions where the parents should have a say. As people, you know, we're talking about inalienable rights. These are rights that you can't deny anybody. And that's part of our medical ethics, it's part of our government ethics, it's part of our humanity. So for those who try to do this to their own children, or those who agree that this is acceptable, I have to strongly disagree, because we're ruining people's lives. We're creating a huge amount of depression, stress, suicide. The statistics on these things are staggering. The way it, you know, affects people's entire lives and the type of issues it creates within the family. And I think the solution is we have to take a stand, both verbally, as I'm doing now, talking to people, protesting, but also legally. We need to make the legal changes that prevent people from doing to their children what the parents of Leelah did to her, and so many other trans people who are denied the right to be themselves, denied even the chance to seek a therapist who's medically approved to deal with these issues, not somebody who's just there to shame someone and try to convince them on religious grounds, not medical grounds, to live a different way. That's not medicine. That's not right. And I hope you'll join me in making these changes, because this is really one of the biggest issues we face. I encourage you to read the suicide note, the links that I've posted in the description, and to be part of the change that we want to make in this world, and not just let these lives continue to be basically not ruined, but things can get better when you become an adult. Suicide is not the answer for a lot of people. You can gain your independence, you can regain your life, liberty, and happiness, but it's not fair that these kids who live in these houses should have things like that done to them, to deny the medical care that they need. All right. Peace and love. Stay strong.